We have seen previously how we use a meter scale in order to measure the length of objects. So now let's say I have a coin. Now I want to measure the diameter of this coin using a meter scale. So over here, I have considered a special kind of meter scale where it is marked from 0 to 15 centimeters. This is a particular portion of the meter scale. And using this, I want to measure the diameter of this coin. So I place the scale such that the zero mark on the scale coincides with the starting point of the coin. So now when I place it along the central line of the coin, I find that the diameter of the coin lies somewhere in between 2.6 centimeters and 2.7 centimeters. Or in other words, it is not coinciding with either of the 2.6 centimeter mark or the 2.7 centimeter mark. So what do I say is the reading? Do I say it is 2.6 centimeters or do I say it is 2.7 centimeters? Now we have previously seen that the least count of a meter scale or the minimum distance that can be measured using a meter scale is 1 millimeter. So over here we find that the diameter lies somewhere in between 2.6 centimeters and 2.7 centimeters. So in between that 0.6 and 0.7 centimeter mark in between 2 and 3, we do not have an accurate reading. So clearly using a meter scale or this special sort of a meter scale that is marked from 0 to 15, we are unable to measure the diameter of a coin. So what do we use in order to get an accurate reading? We use a special instrument that is known as a vernier caliper. Now, if you look closely, this picture represents a vernier caliper. The vernier caliper has two jaws at the bottom. Jaw J1, which is a fixed jaw. This jaw J1 is attached with the main scale. On the main scale, you can see is marked certain gradations. Now, these gradations on the main scale correspond to what we saw on a meter scale. So in this case, again, we have considered a portion of the meter scale where the scale ends at 17. Now, jaw J2 is fixed with another scale that is known as the vernier scale. It is this vernier scale that makes the vernier caliper more accurate than a normal meter scale. This vernier scale is on jaw J2. Now, this jaw, that is J2, is a movable jaw. So what we need to measure is kept in between J1 and J2. As J1 is fixed, we move J2 to and fro in this manner to keep the object in between these two jaws. And in this manner, we get the reading with the help of a vernier caliper. Now, if you look further, you will find that there are two other jaws, J3 and J4. Now, you will be interested to learn that jaw J1 and J2 are usually used for measuring the external dimensions of any object. Let's say we have a hollow cylinder and we want to measure the external diameter. So jaw J1 and J2 in that case are used. But what if we want to measure the internal diameter? Well, in that case, jaws J3 and J4 will be used in order to measure the internal dimensions. Again, if you look closely, you will find that at the end of the vernier caliper, there is another object. Now, this object is responsible for measuring the depth. As we slide the movable jaw J2, that object slides back and forth along. And with the help of that, we are able to measure the depth of any instrument or any object which we want to. So using this vernier caliper, which is calibrated with the main as well as the vernier scale, let us see how we measure the diameter of the coin accurately. So over here we have seen that the fixed scale is known as the main scale and the sliding scale or the movable scale is the vernier scale. And both these scales are employed in order to get an accurate reading. So now let us get into the depths of the working principle of a vernier caliper. Now over here, the part that is depicted in blue is the vernier scale or the movable scale. And the part depicted in white is the main scale. Now, if you look closely, you will see that the length of 10 divisions on the vernier scale corresponds to 9 divisions of the main scale, as you can clearly see from the picture. So what does this imply? This implies that since each division of the main scale is equal to 1 millimeter, and therefore 9 divisions of the main scale is equal to 9 millimeter, we can say that 10 divisions of the vernier scale will be equal to 9 divisions on the main scale. Now, the length of 9 divisions on the main scale is equal to 9 millimeter. So, I can write that 10 divisions of vernier scale is equal to 9 millimeters. So, after having written this, with the help of simple unitary method, I will be able to find out the length of one division. So, one division of the vernier scale will be nothing but 9 by 10 millimeters. 9 by 10 millimeters, which is equal to 0.9 millimeters. Thus, we find that the length of one division of the vernier scale is equal to 0.9 millimeters, whereas the length of one division on the main scale is equal to 1 millimeters. Let us see what this further implies. The smallest distance that can be measured by the vernier caliper is known as the vernier constant, or the least count of the vernier caliper. Now, what does the least count imply? The least count implies the minimum distance that can be measured with the help of a vernier caliper. So, what is the least count? The least count in a vernier caliper is defined as, numerically, value of one main scale division minus value of one vernier scale division. So, in this case, we have found out that the value of one main scale division is 1 millimeter, and the value of one vernier scale division is 0.9 millimeter. So 1 millimeter minus 0.9 millimeters, which gives me 0.1 millimeter, is the vernier constant, or the least count of the vernier caliper in the case that we have considered. This 0.1 millimeter is the minimum distance that can be measured using a vernier caliper. So we found out how we can calculate the least count of a vernier caliper. Now, in the vernier caliper we considered, we found that 10 divisions on the vernier scale corresponds to 9 divisions on the main scale. So that is a special case for a vernier caliper, which is a particular vernier caliper which we have considered. Now, it is not necessary always that 10 divisions on the vernier scale will always correspond to 9 divisions on the main scale. The vernier scale might have different divisions corresponding to different divisions on the main scale. So, in order to calculate the least count for any vernier caliper, we need to generalize the formula which we previously had. So, in order to do this, we need to realize an important fact about vernier calipers. That is, the length of n divisions on the vernier scale will always be equal to the length of n minus 1 divisions on the main scale. So using this, let us see how we can generalize the formula. So we consider the value of one main scale division as x. So if one main scale division has a value of x, n minus 1 divisions on the main scale will have a value n minus 1 into x. Now, we have previously seen that the length of n divisions on the vernier scale corresponds to the length of n minus 1 divisions on the main scale. So, I can write that the length of n divisions of the vernier scale is equal to n minus 1x, because these will be equal. So the length of n divisions of vernier scale is equal to n minus 1x. Now using this, I can easily calculate by simple unitary method the length of one division of the vernier scale. So I write the length of one division of the vernier scale is equal to n minus 1x divided by n. So this value gives me the length or the value of one division on the vernier scale. Now using this particular value, let us see how we can calculate the least count of the vernier caliper. So the vernier constant or the least count of the vernier caliper is numerically defined as the value of one main scale division minus the value of one vernier scale division. We have considered the value of one main scale division is x, and we found out that the value of one vernier scale division is n minus 1 into x divided by n. So this will give me the least count of the vernier caliper. Now I can simplify this equation in order to get the result, which is the least count. So I perform the LCM first and I obtain a result like this. Now as you can see, nx is present both in the positive as well as negative in the same equation. So I can cancel it out and I get a simplified equation which gives me x by n. Now what is x? X is the value of one main scale division. And what is n? N is the number of divisions on the vernier scale. Thus we have obtained a general formula that which we can apply for any vernier caliper. That is, the least count of the vernier caliper is equal to value of one main scale division divided by total number of divisions of the vernier scale. And this will give me the least count of any vernier caliper. So now I will proceed to measure the diameter of this coin with the help of a vernier caliper, which I was unable to measure using a meter scale. Now firstly, when I consider the vernier caliper, I will have to notice one thing, that the zero on the vernier scale that is on the movable jaw corresponds with the zero on the main scale, that is on the fixed jaw. Now if I find that these two zeros coincide with one another, it means my vernier caliper is free from any error. Since it is free from any errors, I proceed directly to the measurement of the diameter. So I move the movable jaw and I bring the object to be measured and place it against the fixed jaw in this manner. Now once I have placed it against the fixed jaw, I need to move the movable jaw back to coincide with the other end of the object. Now as you can see, I have made the object coincide with both the jaws. So this means that the object is held tightly in place. Now I will proceed to find out what the diameter of this object is. If you look closely, you will find that the zero mark on the vernier scale lies somewhere in between the 2.6 and the 2.7 centimeter mark on the main scale. Now since the main scale is just like any other meter scale, the reading that we are getting is similar to the reading which we obtained in the case of a meter scale. Now this is where the vernier scale comes into picture. You will find that there are certain points or markings on the vernier scale which are lying just below the main scale. So let us see how these markings help us. Over here, we have to calculate the distance or the length by which the zero mark on the vernier scale is ahead of the 2.6 centimeter mark on the main scale. That is the distance AB. AB is the distance in between the red line and the blue line. As you can see, it is a very, very minute distance. So in order to calculate the diameter of this coin effectively and accurately, we have to calculate this distance AB. So how do we calculate this distance? Firstly, we start looking at the vernier scale. Now from the zero mark on the vernier scale, find out which position or which mark of the vernier scale corresponds to a mark on the main scale. When you reach the mark, the first of its kind, we consider that particular mark for our calculations. So in this case, you will see that the zero mark is not coinciding with any scale on the main one, neither is the 1, 2 or the third on the vernier scale. However, the fourth mark on the vernier scale corresponds to a mark on the main scale. So we have to consider four divisions on the vernier scale for our calculation. And this is how we will get an accurate reading for AB. So let us see how. So if you look again closely, you will see, as I mentioned to you, that the fourth mark on the vernier scale corresponds with a gradation on the main scale. This gradation is the 3 cm mark on the main scale. Now if you see, we find that four divisions on this particular vernier scale is corresponding with four divisions on the main scale after the 2.6 cm mark. So this is the 2.6 cm mark. If you start counting after the 2.6 cm mark, you will find that there are 1, 2, 3, 4 divisions, and even on the vernier scale, we have considered 4 divisions after 0. 1, 2, 3, 4. Thus, generalizing this situation, we can say that AB, which is the length by which the 0 on the vernier scale is ahead of the 2.6 cm mark, plus length of P divisions of the vernier scale, that is, this particular length is equal to the value of P divisions of the main scale. So using this formula, knowing the length of P divisions of vernier scale and the value of P divisions of the main scale, we can calculate the length AB, which will give us the accurate reading for the diameter. So we again write the formula, that is the general formula. AB plus the length of P divisions of the vernier scale equal to the value of P divisions of the main scale. So I rewrite this as AB. What will be the length of P divisions of the vernier scale? If we consider the length of P divisions, it will be nothing but P into the length of one division. So this will be P into the length of one division of the vernier scale. Similarly, if I have to find out the value of P divisions of the main scale, I will write P into the value of one division of the main scale, value of one division of the main scale. So instead of this, I rewrite it as this. So I have obtained the equation as P into length of one division of the vernier scale plus AB is equal to P into length of one division of the main scale. Now I bring this part of the equation, which is on the left hand side, to the right hand side. Now as you can see, P is common to both the terms. So I can take P as common and write length of one division on the main scale minus length of one division of the vernier scale. Now, if you look closely at this part of the equation, which gives us length of one division of main scale minus length of one division of vernier scale, it is nothing but the least count of the vernier scale. So in place of this entire thing, I can simply write P into the least count of the vernier scale, which is equal to AB, or the distance which we are interested to measure. Thus, AB is equal to P into least count of vernier scale. So now, knowing P and knowing the least count of the vernier scale, we can easily calculate AB. So this AB that we calculated by multiplying P with the least count of the vernier scale is also known as the vernier reading. So how do we find out the total reading or the reading that we desire? That reading, the total reading, is given by the sum of main scale reading and the vernier reading. So let us see how, using both the main scale reading as well as the vernier reading, we can calculate accurately the diameter of the coin. So firstly, we are going to calculate this length, which is AB, because we already know the main scale reading, which is 2.6 centimeters. So in order to calculate the length AB, we have to find out the vernier reading as P into the least count LC. Now P is 4, because 4 divisions on the vernier scale, or the fourth mark of the vernier scale, is corresponding to a mark on the main scale, which is the 3 centimeter mark. So P is equal to 4. And the least count of the vernier scale we can easily find out by using the formula x by n. X is the value of one main scale division, which is 1 millimeter, and n is the total number of divisions on the vernier scale, which in this case is 10. So 1 by 10 gives me 0.1 millimeters. Thus, the least count is 0.1 millimeters. 4 into 0.1 millimeters is equal to 0.4 millimeters. So thus, I have obtained the vernier reading as 0.4 millimeters. Thus, I can easily calculate the total reading by adding the main scale reading, which is 2.6 centimeters or 26 millimeters, with the vernier reading, that is 0.4 millimeters. So the total reading I write as 26 plus 0.4, which is equal to 26.4 millimeters. Thus, we have effectively found out accurately the diameter of the coin as 26.4 millimeters, which is also equal to 2.64 centimeters. Now, in our previous case, the vernier scale that we considered, we have considered a scale that is free from zero error. What is zero error? Zero error is the distance between the zero of the main scale and zero of the vernier scale. Before we started measuring the diameter of the coin, I told you whether the zero mark on the main scale coincides with the zero mark on the vernier scale. If these two marks coincide, it means that the distance in between these two marks is zero, which means that the vernier scale, which we have dealt with so far, was free from zero error. However, this might not always be the case. There can be two possibilities of the zero mark of the vernier scale. This zero mark can lie on the right side of the zero mark on the main scale, or it can also lie on the left side of the zero mark of the main scale. Both these cases gives rise to two types of zero errors. So let us see what those two types of zero errors are and how we can correct them in order to get an accurate reading. In this vernier caliper, you will notice that the zero mark on the vernier scale is lying to the right of the zero mark of the main scale. This kind of zero error is known as positive zero error. Why? Because the zero mark of the vernier scale is lying to the right of the zero mark of the main scale, or in other words, it is lying on the positive side of the number line. So this is why it is known as the positive zero error. So when we consider a vernier scale having positive zero error, It means whatever readings are taken with the help of this vernier caliper will actually be greater than the reading we desire. So we have to correct this positive zero error. Let us see how we can do so. Firstly, we have to calculate what the error is. The positive zero error numerically is given by the coinciding division of the vernier scale with the main scale multiplied by the least count. So this will give us the positive zero error. Now first we calculate the positive zero error and then we measure whatever length or diameter we have to measure. That will give us the total reading. Now this reading will actually be greater than the reading we desire because of the positive zero error. So from the total reading, we subtract the positive zero error. Once we subtract the positive zero error, we get the corrected reading or the reading which we actually desire and the one which is accurate. So we found out how we can correct the positive zero error. Now the other kind of zero error is known as the negative zero error. If you look at the vernier caliper we have considered over here, you will see that the zero on the vernier scale lies to the left hand side of the zero of the main scale. This implies that this zero is lying to the left hand side of the number line, and this is why this kind of zero error is known as the negative zero error. Negative zero error implies that whatever readings we take with the help of this caliper will be less than the actual reading. So let us see how we can get the actual or the corrected reading. Firstly, again, we have to calculate the value of the negative zero error. The value of negative zero error is given by the coinciding division of vernier scale with the main scale multiplied by the least count. And this gives us the negative zero error. So after finding out the negative zero error, we proceed to find out the length or diameter of whichever object we have considered. That will give us the total reading. Now since this total reading is less than the reading which we desire because of negative zero error, we add the value of negative zero error to the total reading. And this gives us the corrected reading, which is the accurate reading free from the negative zero error. So this is how, using a vernier caliper, we can measure the length or the diameter of any object which we are unable to using a meter scale. Why? Because the least count of a meter scale is 0.1 centimeters, whereas the least count of the vernier scale which we have considered over here is 0.01 centimeters. In general, in every case, a vernier scale or a vernier caliper is always more accurate than a meter scale. So, in order to measure length or diameter of those objects which we cannot do using a meter scale, we use a vernier scale.